And welcome back. We are in the gullet once again. And before I do anything, I want to check inventory. The egg. So funny, it's a quest item. Let me look at this thing first. Candy dispenser. This rectangular device is topped with the head of a furry, vaguely feline creature. The head appears to be dozing. Occasionally it makes soft cooing sounds in its sleep. I wonder if this has anything to do with the furry creatures in the egg. One of which killed all its friends, quote-unquote, and... for friends. And then me. That's loud as hell. This is a rectangular device with the likeness of a furry, feline-like creature's head at one end. It may be some sort of toy or... Sorry guys, I'm opening a drink here. Or a candy dispenser. The device grows warm in your hand, and with a wide yawn, the creature opens over large eyes and gazes up at you with love-struck awe. Murr? So cute. You notice that the furry head is remarkably similar to the little creatures you saw in the synth egg. Well, that's my answer. Perhaps the two objects date from the same period in the past, or were brought to the bloom from some alien world. With twin clicks, the outlines of long, slender, four-fingered hands protrude from either side of the device. I'm gonna examine first. You turn the device over to examine the casing. The creature coos with interest at the sight of the floor. On the bottom, opposite the head, you find a carving of a stylized sun with a hole at its center. You don't recognize the symbol, however, and can't tell if it's a maker's mark or something else entirely. The creature whoops as you flip the device over to look at the sun carving on the base. It still means nothing to you. What's your name? Murr, the creature responds, rubbing its furry head against the pad of your thumb. Head on a stick, eh? Tiber says, leaning in. Saw something like this at a party once, except it wasn't an adorable little creature. He ponders it, trying to remember. Ah yes, it was this sort of fleshy stalk with seven faces. It opened its mouths and screamed, "Satisfy my breathing holes!" Tiber clears his throat. There's a thousand ways to kill the mood at an orgy, and that turned out to be one of them. Okay, Tiber. Can you speak? The creature purrs deep in its throat, making the device rumble in your palm. What a charming little thing, Callistia says coolly, eyeing it with distaste. Can you speak? Can you speak? Can you frickin' speak? Eritus, you have nothing to say? Squeeze the protruding hands. It's the only thing left to do, other than just put it away. I got a cipher. I got can- I got Pez. This is like a Pez dispenser. You pinch the hands against the sides of the device. Eee! The creature says, its eyes widening. A tiny bulge moves up its tinier throat. Eee! Eee! Blarf! It spits out a rectangular tablet with a tiny poot! We gained a pastel blue candy. You pick up the object, it smells of fruit and makes your skin tingle. You look back at the creature. Mrrr, it says, its eyes darting between the tablet and your mouth. Apparently you're supposed to eat it. What the hell? Heals 30 points of health and permanently increases intellect by 1. Should I save it for when I need health? An obnoxiously cute feline creature spat out this rectangular tablet. When you squeeze its hands, it smells of fruit, yet it feels inorganic to the touch. Holding it makes your skin tingle, a sensation that promises great mental succor if you ate it. Can I instead give it to someone else? Like, I think... Tiber? Who doesn't have... two things at Tiber? Or one thing, even. There's another thing, 30 points of health. Confers shell armor. Give this a Tyvir. You didn't even complain in an echoing way. So you'll save that for when I need health. Although the intellect will always help, right? But, let's see. Because I want to see if we get anything else. Things so loud. Murr, the creature on top of the device says, overjoyed to be out in the light again. The hands protruding from either side waggle ever so slightly. What did I say? Can you speak? We got another one. You pinch the device's hands again. Ee! The creature murmurs, looking concerned. Ee! Urgh! Patches of its fur are falling out, but it carries on with unwavering determination. Mwah, blarf! It spits out a second tablet with a poot, gazes up at you in round-eyed, rolling horror, and dies in your hand. We got another pastel candy. It does the same exact thing. And we lost it. It's gone. Cool. The creature's fur... That's sad, though. Fur falls away and a shower of tiny hairs in its flesh puckers and dries, tearing like old paper. The large eyes burst with an oddly satisfying double pop. It seems you will be getting no more tablets from this device. Kalashi's sighs. Well, a lesson learned for all of us, I suppose. Well, except for the creature, I suppose. Really? We got Pez out of the thing. Nothing emerges from the creature's ruptured throat but a wheezing gasp and a puff of putrid air. Dismantle the device and search for valuables inside. Hopefully no more... what do you call it? Ciphers? Success! You pry at the sides of the device, slipping your fingernails along the fleshy seams beneath the now useless hands and tugging at them as carefully as you can. Without warning, the device cracks apart with a spray of pink fluid and tiny organs. Ah, I got another cipher, goddammit. Sorting through the gore, you find a tiny blinking nodule. Perhaps this is what was keeping the creature alive all this time. We gained a life support nodule. Refills all stat pools. Oh, nice. Might, speed, and intellect. This flesh-colored device, you don't even have to use... It consumes movement. You don't even have to use an action for this. This flesh-colored device looks like a slug that absorbed a blinking device. It moves with writhing pulses and gleefully attaches itself to any exposed skin. Whatever its purpose, when attached to the skin, it offers great healing to the user. After a short while, it becomes brittle and dissipates into dust with a screech. Yeah, much like the thing that was holding it. Okay, so we've never had so many. Minus 5% on all tasks. It says twice. Is that cumulative? Symptoms increasing. Minus 1 might, speed, and intellect edge. And then minus 15% on all tasks. I think if I hold too many, I explode or something. Okay, I'm gonna give a candy dispenser to Calistes. Because now I want to look at this egg again. You know what? Before I look at the egg, I want to save my game. I believe we're 10 minutes in and I haven't even, like, moved. We have to see where we are. Episode 120, guys. I always make sure it's actually there. And it is. Now this egg. You pick up the egg and the all-too-familiar music fills your ears. An image takes shape on the egg's surface. You see a bird's-eye view of your own body. It sprawls face down upon the ground, its throat torn out. Good God. Is that like my soul or something? Blood seeps from the wound, forming a little puddle around your head. There is no sign of the pink creature or any of the others. It seems the spectacle, or whatever it was, is over. The scene on the surface of the egg is unchanged. Your corpse lies motionless on the ground. Nothing else stirs. Now, if you guys remember, even though it was I am dead somehow in that thing, yet alive, but it killed me in real life. When it was attacking the reflection of me. Try placing the egg on the ground. Instead of tipping over as you might expect, the egg balances neatly on its bottom end. When you let go of the egg, the cheerful music stops. Huh. Push the egg over. You give the egg a shove, it rolls over onto its side and then bounces back up again. It's a weevil. Remember weevils? Smash it. Grabbing hold of a weapon, you swing at the egg with all your might, but it merely rolls over onto its side and then stands up again. Really, dear, Calistia says, just because it killed you doesn't mean you have to break it. Weird. Okay. There's some loot over here. Right there. Ready. Some bones. And some 45 shins. I hate when we don't hear it tink. Makes me think we didn't get it. Let's talk to Siowan. Despair lines the face of this ghostly figure. His aquiline features are clean and strong. His head shaven. His eyes, empty sockets, are bleeding, but they turn to you. Hello, he says. His voice is deep and sepulchral. I'm glad you're here. Kill me, please. He thinks, she looks substantial. Could she arrive here without being eaten? The name sounds familiar. What happened to your eyes? I don't know, he says flatly. I came here too long ago, and memories are the first things the gullet takes. Then hope, then the senses. He looks down. All I know is I've been here a long, long time. Why are you standing here? Listening, he says with a slow nod in the direction of the whirlpool. It sounds like a heartbeat, doesn't it? He leans forward, ever so slightly. It sounds like peace. You ever think that standing near this thing is what's making you want to die? Blue tide, huh? He goes still for a moment, considering your words. Perhaps, he says at last. Or perhaps it's the fact that I'm trapped here, and I'll never, ever escape until I'm dead. But have no fear. I'm not giving myself to whatever is down there. He leans away from the whirlpool, ever so slightly. I've seen what happens to those who throw themselves into those waters. His mouth twists. They're torn apart, but they don't die. They live on as part of the bloom. We hear them weeping sometimes. Or screaming. Why do you want me to kill you? He looks at you, shocked, and speaks slowly. Why do I want you to kill me? Are you completely blind? Look around you. Look at this place. Do you think I want to dissolve here? The bloom is eating me, digesting me, and I'm stuck in its gut. What life is left for me? He thinks, I am already dead. Anything would be better than this. Tell me again. He turns his empty face to yours and stares for a few moments. I am food for the bloom. I am dying, not living. What happens if I kill you? Then I die. I disappear. The bloom gets no more of my essence. Whatever afterlife may await us is my reward. If you don't... He falls silent, sighing. If you don't, I'll be here, fighting despair, listening to the weeping of the others, and trading hopeless words until I fade away. And listening to those idiots fight in the corner over there. The bloom is weakened, fractionally. I die. I cease suffering. I don't stand here, blind in the wet dark, until the bloom digests me. You shouldn't be so willing to throw away your life. Really, he says with a scornful smile. A thread of blood spills from an eye socket, and he wipes it, leaving a blurred arc of crimson across his cheekbone. My life is over, stranger. The bloom is digesting me, and I can't escape. Nothing I do here will matter. So tell me, why shouldn't I throw away my life, as you put it? What value does it have down here? What would you have me wait for? You aren't alone down here. Why don't you join with the others and fight your way out? Indigo. Have you seen the others? Most of them are wild beasts. The rest are losing their minds. No, stranger. There's no hope for us. No future. Only the horror you see before you. Should I? Killing one with a normal weapon isn't gonna work. Red Tide. The weapon passes to him as if isn't there at all. Do I look as if that might work? Slash his throat with the transdimensional scalpel. As the blade passes through his flesh, a look of surprise crosses his face. The scalpel cuts deeply into his insubstantial trachea, and a spray of horrifyingly substantial blood spews from the wound. Even as he fades away, Siowan finds a way to smile. Guess we're helping him. I mean, I don't think we can take him out with us. We're going deeper. My thanks. Okay. Interesting. Sure enough. Are these bloom tongues I can mess with? A cluster of bloom tubes sprout from the floor. One of them, thinner than the rest, has developed a leak, and its vile juices flow energetically into the pool. Tie the tube into a knot? Why do we want to do this? We got 85% chance. Maybe we should use someone else's stuff. Aretus, 90%. Tiber gets to 100. Let's use Tiber, but 80%. You deftly manipulate the tube, kinking it to avoid being sprayed while you work, and you manage, mostly, a few drops of the rancid stuff land on your boots. With the fluid pressure momentarily relieved, you expertly tie the bloom tube into a knot. When you release it, the knot holds. No more fluid leaks from this cluster. The level of the pool drops noticeably. Huh. Interesting. Yes. Now that the tube has been blocked off, the bloom's juices have stopped leaking into the pool. The cluster of tubes looks like it could support your weight, but they're not long enough to help you climb all the way to the bottom of the empty pool. Okay. So that's why we did that. There's people fighting, I guess, over here. This fat, blubbery flesh is soft and yielding, threatening to suck you down if you try to wade through it. Right, what about this thing? You know what? That's messing with it more. I want to go here last, because this is where we... you know, gonna end up.
All right.
I want to finish exploring before we lock ourselves into anything.
With alacrity.
I think we came from here. A wall of bones grows jagged and sharp, covered with tiny protrusions that would rip bare flesh. Yep, here's the Muradin. Everything's here. Okay. So, we've explored how much so far? Good amount. This is a small map. You can tell by how big it is. Can we, like, move the map in and out? No, we can't. Alright. I think I'm gonna go this way.
To action!
Yeah. Disgusting action.
Alright.
Oh, there's another tongue cluster. Oh, who's this? Hello there. Artaglio. It's Artaglio. A washed out, somewhat insubstantial Artaglio bulls toward you. The boozy cheer has vanished from his red and blotchy face. Now he's a study in fury. Though he seems ghostly, hardly a physical threat, he radiates a nearly palpable heat. He might be able to attack us with mental, transdimensional damage, all kinds of things. So that's right. I thought he might not be dead. He was pulled into the bloom cluster. So there's something huge here who has fallen. You bitch. You rancid, cheating bitch. You tricked me into letting the bloom devour me. And now I get to watch it siphon away the parts of me that were best? I should have known better than to trust a cast-off. Make this right. Come on. Do it now. I had no choice, Artaglio. He spits. No choice? You had plenty of choice. You didn't have to open the maw. But you did. You did, and you fed me to it. Just like a cast-off. Just like all you accursed kin. He thinks, I can't believe I listened to her. I was the one with no choice. That's kind of a lie. These are lies to me. I know it doesn't say lie, but to me it's lies because that's not my intention. I really just wanted to open the maw. You questioned me? You followed me. You made that choice, Artaglio, no matter how charismatic I am. Red tide, I think. Oh no, silver a moderate amount. Quite a bit. And indigo a small amount. He backs off in the face of your vehemence, holding his hands up. Aye, that I did, cast off. That I did. It was my mistake and my dishonor. I can absorb you into my mind. Alright. Is this an okay thing to do? I've been doing some pretty questionable things lately. Questionable to me, at least. I can offer you more, Artaglio. I can absorb you into my mind, if you'll let me. Better than all this. He considers your offer. Got any rum in there? He smirks. I'm sure it's better than dying here. Do what you need to do. Tidal affinity. Try to draw Artaglio into the labyrinth. We'll go with 90. You reach out and place your fingers on Artaglio's chest. He looks surprised but says nothing. You close your eyes, open your mind, and will him into the labyrinth. Perhaps it's its weakened form, or perhaps it's the strength of your intellect, but you feel his consciousness awakening inside your mind. He's brought his sardonic humor and his taste for rum. We don't have any rum in there. As his mind is reborn inside yours, his body fades in the real world until nothing is left. Okay. Oh, that helps him. It helps him a little, and it helps our knowledge more. Blue tide, small amount, and gold tide, a tiny amount. Bye. Have fun. A new reflection is forming in the labyrinth. Be nice to Choi and, what's her name? The other girl. And, Interfere? Interfere can take care of himself. Interact with that.
On it.
Oh, wait, I don't want to... Alacrity. That's interact? I don't want to mess with that yet. We'll get the loot. 40 shins and an amplified encephalic rush. Bloop. Let me take one. Because I'm getting a little low.
Alright.
On intellect. I like being low on intellect. I should have taken the smaller ones, actually. Because we have so many of them. Actually, we only have one. But, Calisthenes has one, has a few, but I think they're the amplified ones, yeah. Alright, let's mess with the... Oh, there's a decor there. Nice decor! Let's mess with the bloom cluster first. So much to do in here. Another cluster of bloom tongues rises from a swollen mound of flesh. The sound they make is like a soft hiss, punctuated with obscenely wet slaps of flesh. Let's communicate with the magmatic annulet. I'm glad I kept that thing. The voices grow louder, pushing aside your thoughts, drawing memories into your conscious mind. A sharp pain blossoms in your head as the tongues fixate upon a memory and begin to tear it free. I'm going to allow them, because every time they do that, we get a memory. And as far as I know, we don't lose the memory. 3 damage. The pain grows sharper still, like a hot knife behind your eyes. A memory bursts into your conscious mind. You're in the heart of Tabat territory now. The ceiling of their underground city is so high that you can barely see its curves, but the flickering illumination on the carvings there make a ghastly show. Demonic figures disport among the bodies of fallen enemies, atrocities shouted down from the heavens. But this is not what you're here for. You're here for the Underspine, their god and slave. A massive machine intelligence that guides them through their rituals. They're god and slave. What a dichotomy. You're hovering near the great bulk of the machine, placing your detonations around the torus of its center, and you think your stealth has been exemplary, but a pinhole spotlight centers on you, and a focused beam of sound strikes your ears. The processing and memory retention cells are higher. If you wish to destroy me utterly, place your explosives there. And then a smaller whispered, "Thank you." The memory ends, and the bloom tongues sag drunkenly against each other, sated by their feast. You sense that you may be able to seize control of them now. We'll go to 90. Ooh, cool, we got stat pools restored. You reach across the barrier that separates your consciousness from that of the tongues. They resist you at first, but your will is stronger than theirs, and the agitated voices subside. You find that you can control their movements as if they were a part of you. The roots of this tongue cluster grow thick beneath the floor of the chamber. Unlike the tongues you have encountered before, they seem to be cut off from the rest of the bloom. Now that you are connected to the tongues, you hear whispers coming from somewhere nearby. Let's try to sense what's happening in the room first, I don't know. The tongue's roots form a tight web throughout the chamber, and their senses within its boundaries are unusually sharp. You can feel raw, burning pain where bloom flesh chafes against an ancient metal suit. That. Something about the material irritates the flesh. In time, it might be insisted, but until then, the tongues will endure the pain. Is that a word? Insisted? It's like two different spellings. You insist upon being insisted. Same. It's gonna tell me the same thing. Yeah, focus on the source of the whispers. The whispers arise from a corner of the room, and you realize that the roots of this cluster all grow toward that point. It's a maw, you realize. Another maw that has hidden itself from mortal sight. Indeed, by cutting off this chamber from the rest of the bloom, it has even managed to hide itself from other maws and tongues. This chamber is a blind spot, a locus of independent consciousness. It is, in a sense, a separate being, a child of the bloom. force the mod to reveal itself? There it is. You whisper to the maw, and your voice travels through the tongues and along their roots, joining the whispers of the maw, bending it to your will. After a few moments, the maw responds, shimmering into being in a corner of the room. Commune with the maw. You can sense the mind of the maw, old and patient and strong, yet a child. Lines of psychic energy emanate from it to touch every corner of the room. Its whispers have a cruel and dismal edge. You sense long millennia in the dark, feeding upon the half-digested leavings of other maws. You release your grip on the amulet, and the voices of the bloom tongues fade. I wonder what that maw might want.